You're listening to the Becoming More Me podcast with me, Theresa Lear Levine. You're already enough, but if you're anything like me, you thrive when you're stretching, creating, and aligning with the person you feel called to be, and creating greater calm, clarity, and confidence in your life, as well as room for pleasure and expansion. Through amazing stories, conversations, and offerings, this podcast is here to inspire and support you. Get ready to release the negative, reinforce the positive, and elevate our consciousness and vibe together as we tap into our limitless potential to transform and grow. Hey, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Becoming More Me. Super excited to introduce you to my new friend, Emily Reuschel, today. We have been becoming friends for the last few months, and I just love her. I know you will, too. Emily is a farmer's wife, a mom of two, but soon to be three, mama, an entrepreneur, sought-after motivational speaker, podcast host, leader of retreats, and masterminds that propel rural women toward their truest, most aligned goals and priorities. And I had a lot of fun going on her podcast just a couple months ago. Her podcast is called Gather in Growth, and it's awesome. You should definitely check it out. Emily is a proclaimed lifelong people pleaser, box checker, high achiever. I can relate to so much of this. Emily was at her dream job. She had, you know, benefits, flexible hours, incredible coworkers, the option to even bring her kids to work, when she decided to stop ignoring the voice in her heart that told her she was meant for something different and start trying to figure out what that was. And that brought her to the place that she is now, where she helps other rural women to cross that bridge and do the same through the process of getting clear on what they want, releasing their inner dialogue that tells them it's impossible, and going after the goals that are otherwise keeping them awake at night without giving up the small town life they love. I'm so excited about this conversation today, Emily. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me. Gosh, there's like nothing more humbling and awkward than listening to someone read your professional bio. I mean, all of those things are true, but it's like,
Yeah, it's always strange. I always try to change it up a little bit because I know that I always get tired of hearing people just read my bio. I'm just like, okay. You know, I always have conversations with people after either they're on my show or I'm on theirs. I love it when people do change things up like that. Do you like that, or do you prefer like
questions? And I prefer that. And even so, I really love emceeing events. And typically I have the event coordinator give me, you know, the professional bios that they were given. And then I just take them and I dig into like other people's social media and their websites. Yeah. And like, I just rewrite my own introduction. And the speakers are always like, wow, like that was such a cool intro, because, you know, we just,
it's just fun. The coolest thing now is like, we can use like ChatGPT and we can be like, take some stuff from a website, take some stuff from here, write me a bio. And then I still rewrite it. But I love the ease of being able to put something together that's a little bit more original without a whole lot of work.
Yes. Yeah, I'm so with you there. So anyway, I'm so grateful to be here. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. I'd love it if we could start with you just kind of telling us a little bit about your personal life, your hobbies, what your day-to-day life is like, so we can get to know you a little bit better, where you live.
Absolutely. So I found myself here in the middle of West Central Illinois on my husband's family farm. We grow primarily corn and soybeans. His family has been here for generations and generations, but I didn't grow up in agriculture. I didn't grow up on a farm. I grew up in what I thought was a small town in like the Metro East St. Louis area of Southern Illinois. I knew that in my future, I wanted to live more out in the country, you know, raise my kids in a place where they were frolicking in the backyard as they literally are right now, surrounded by green. But moving back to the farm and living this rural lifestyle, although it's what I wanted, was certainly an adjustment. So we've been here for almost 7 years now, and I truly would not have it any other way. Like you said, I have a 6-year-old, a 4-year-old, and an unexpected blessing on the way.
Nice.
And so professionally, I started as an elementary school teacher. I spent several years in the nonprofit space. Like you said, it was kind of my dream job, like incredible situation with great people doing impactful work. But I just got to the point where I recognized like there's something more, like there's something else, there's something different. And so through a long and winding trail of personal and professional development alongside a health journey, I started sharing online really as a drive to connect with other women in small towns and rural communities who were like me. Like I said, I love this lifestyle. I love living in a small town. I love being on the farm.
When you were working that job, were you on the farm and in the small town, or was that before?
Yes. Yes. Okay. So I actually taught for several years before we moved back to the farm. I taught up here for 1 year, assumed I was going to be doing that for the whole rest of my career. Like the teacher and the farmer, how cute are we? They write country songs about this. And on a total leap of faith, like had an opportunity to leave the classroom for a local YMCA position. I was a program director, oversaw all of our youth and family programming. So it was very much within my wheelhouse of like kids and after school and summer camp and like the Easter egg hunt, stuff like that. But working in a rural, small nonprofit, I also got thrown into having to figure out accounting and marketing and HR and just all of these things I would have never been exposed to in this career that I thought was the trajectory of my life, this dream job. I'd known I wanted to be a teacher since I was in third grade. And so that's what really started to open my eyes to like, wow, I am capable of so many different things. And I love learning these new skills or these new areas of business that I've never understood before. I'm not one of those entrepreneurs that's like, I knew I'd be an entrepreneur forever. Like I was slinging bracelets on the schoolyard. Like entrepreneur was not on my radar. I tried some business classes in college and promptly decided that I loathed them. This was not the path that I had originally thought. But like I said, I started sharing online really just because I had started to invest in my personal growth and what it looked like to build an intentional life from the inside out, from a health perspective, from a parenting perspective, from just like a personal fulfillment perspective. And I kept looking around like, is anyone else who also lives in these kinds of places having these conversations? I was kind of existing in multiple worlds. The more I got into the personal development space, I was, you know, in these Facebook groups following these accounts online, you know, Jenna Kutcher and Rachel Hollis and all of this. And so I was having a lot of conversations around goal setting or habits or what it meant to potentially start a business. And then also trying to find my place in this world of agriculture and in small towns and rural communities where, like I said, I didn't grow up in this. So I was desperate to find other people who knew what it was like when it was harvest season. My husband was just straight up not home for weeks at a time with a 2-year-old and a newborn. Like this is hard. And so I was fostering all of these connections with women on the online space in that realm. And so you know, trying to find where I fit in between both of these things. Like I want to go after these goals. I have these dreams. I'm understanding that there's a vision for my life outside of what I had always thought was possible. And also I love this life that we lead. So how does that meet? And at the time I didn't see anyone having conversations at the intersection between the two. So it was a very much like, literally like driving home at sunset, why not me kind of moment. Like, what if I was the person that started that conversation? And so I really just created an Instagram account to hopefully attract more people like me and have those types of conversations. And one thing led to another. And now here I am, like really running a full-time business from my, you know, dining room table, or right now I'm recording this podcast in my son's bedroom. And my days are filled with masterminds and coaching conversations with other women in small town, rural communities connected to agriculture who are in the process of figuring out what intentionality looks like in their life. And for some people, that is starting a business. For some people, that's figuring out what it looks like to be a stay-at-home mom. For some people, that's making big career moves. And what I love about the work that I do is it's so individualized. You know, I'm not the kind of coach that has like, oh, here's this 10-step program to do exactly what I've done. Like, I really challenge my community and the women I work with of like, what do you actually want? And a lot of people can't answer that question off the get-go, or we rattle off things that we've internalized along the way. Like, had you asked me that question 10 years ago, well, I want to be a teacher. I want to do this. I want to do that. And none of that was inherently wrong. That's the season I was in at that time. But so many of us have not been given the space or opportunity to really listen to where our gifts are and the life that we ultimately want to build outside of these external forces, whether it be society or our mother-in-law or what our sister's doing or what that girl on the internet is doing.
Yeah. We know what we want and we're just not willing to follow our own intuition or stick with our gut and follow through on it.
Right, right. So really the through line of the work that I do is helping women navigate those personal and professional growth journeys and ask the hard questions and then build the confidence and action steps to actively work towards it.
Yeah, that's awesome. And I feel like, you know, as you're evolving, so is country music. Because I think there's also some newer songs that have, you know, more modern roles. So we just need a good song about a farmer and an entrepreneur.
Yes.
And we'll be all set. And I wouldn't actually be surprised if there's already one out there in some capacity. But it's, you know, I don't know. I don't see how, gosh, you know, when we resist our urge to change and grow and evolve, that's just the most painful thing. So I'm so glad that you leaned into that. So what does it feel like for you, and perhaps even for the people that you work with, to be pursuing big goals in a small town? And how does that maybe like trigger the recovering people pleaser and the box checker that you proclaim to be?
Yes. And I would say for me, looking at the past 4 years or so, that is, well, really even beyond that, has been an incredible journey. As we were approaching moving back to where my husband was raised, his small town, where I didn't know a single person other than my in-laws, I just remember having so much anxiety of, am I even going to be able to make a friend? Are people going to collectively shun me because I'm not from here? What if I don't get a job at the school that I want to? Or what if I do get a job there and people don't like what I'm doing and then they don't like my kids? And as much as I think a lot of women grapple with the opinions of other people, whether it be their peer group, their community, their family, I think a lot of women in small towns feel like we're under a microscope or in a magnifying glass because we do exist in such a small, tight-knit community, which is an incredible blessing in so many ways, but can feel very captivating.
Does it feel like disconnected from the larger world that's out there?
Yeah, sometimes.
Or like it's hard to tap into the different perspectives?
Yeah, sometimes. I think for me, that's like the benefit is I like kind of existing in our little middle of nowhere cornfield. But I think that a lot of people are paralyzed by making any kind of major move outside of the norm. Because, oh my gosh, what are they going to think? And not only that, what are my neighbors going to think? What are the people my husband does business going to think? What are my sister-in-law's going to think? Or my kids' friends or my kids' parents' teacher or my kids' teachers? And so, you know, when it comes to starting a business or making a big major change or starting to share online or starting to podcast, there is this extra layer of, oh my goodness, like someone's not going to like this. Like, and it's going to have a domino effect that's going to crumble our lives. And there is some reality based in, you know, what that could potentially look like. But a lot of this is stories that we're telling ourselves.
Yeah. Like, it takes a little while and a little courage to develop the voice that says, so what?
Right. Right. And I will say, like, when I started sharing online, like I started my own Instagram account that I did not purposely connect with absolutely anyone I knew in my personal life. Like I was meeting all these people from around the country, but like it was a solid year before I shared on my personal Facebook page that this like
exists.
This other public
hey,
Instagram
here's
account,
another aspect of me.
Right. Even existed. And then, you know, when I was leaving my full-time job with really not much more of a plan than I'm just going to take the chance on myself. And here's kind of what my vision is. But like, I do not have it all figured out. People are like, wait, what? What are you doing? And I'm like, I don't know, but we're going to see where it goes. And worst case scenario, like I know I can get another job somewhere. So I'm going to take this chance. And Then also starting the podcast felt like another layer of like standing naked on the street corner. Like
So when
now
you
you.
left your job, were you already doing some of this work on your own, or was it like, now I'm going to start fresh?
I had already built a community online. Had an established Facebook group, a couple thousand followers on Instagram, but nothing that I was doing was in a paid capacity. Like I had started my UDU 82 habit challenge. I was kind of, content creating and engaging in a lot of conversations. I had a lot of ideas around potentially what coaching could look like. But I knew that I wanted to get into speaking. I knew that I wanted to get into podcasting, but none of that existed beyond like, wouldn't it be cool if it was. When I tell you it was a leap of faith, it was a leap of faith.
That's awesome. So let's talk a little bit about habits and goals and this UDU 82 habit challenge that you have.
Yeah.
Guys, I know you're a big fan of like feeling like you have control over your habits, and we do all to a certain extent. How did you learn to do that? What has creating strong intentional habits looked like for you or resulted in as far as outcomes are concerned? And where did that challenge come up from?
Yeah, so I have to trace back to late August, early September of 2019. I was 6 months postpartum with my daughter, my second. I had just walked through a very crazy season at work. Part of my responsibilities at the Y was overseeing our summer camp program. So here I had 100 plus campers, 7:30 to 5:30, 12 weeks out of the summer, 15 or so staff. I'm working
Wow.
60 plus hour weeks
My
pumping.
hero. I could not do that job. No, I can't say
Oh
no. I'm
my
going to put
gosh.
that out there. I couldn't do it. You're
Yeah,
amazing.
I was pumping like 8 times a day, plus nursing around the clock, plus having a 2-year-old. Like my first day back from maternity leave was the first day of staff training. So it, I mean, truly had just been
Exhausted's probably an understatement.
like depleted in every single sense of the term. And so it was the week or so after camp had wrapped up. And I remember sitting on the couch with this sweet baby girl on my lap and just being like, I am low-key miserable. And you couldn't have tell from, I think that a lot of us in that postpartum phase get to that at some point of like,
It's tough.
what is even going on here? But it kind of came to a culmination point of, never in my life had I been really intentional in taking care of my health. I will say, throughout my teens and 20s, I fell into some of the same traps I think a lot of us did at that time period of, oh, I'm just going to go elliptical, or I'm going to try maybe to not eat this or do that. Like, but it was all from that place of shame of like, oh, I want to look good in my swimsuit this summer. I want to blah, 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 whatever. And I think there was something about having a baby girl specifically that it was like, I cannot do that anymore. And this is not what I thought my life was going to look like. Like, here I've worked with kids my entire career. I have these two of my own, and I am not being the mom that I thought that I wanted to be. Like, I come home at the end of the day. I'm frustrated at my kids simply for existing because I'm so depleted. I have poured myself into this career above and beyond. I, am trying to navigate showing up for my husband and figuring out this life on the farm and all of this, and realize like I had put myself so absolutely dead last that basically everything felt like it was crumbling around me, even though on the outside looking in, here I have a great job, this beautiful, healthy baby, this huge, things that were going well on paper, but on
And
the
none of it
inside,
matters without the other stuff. It just doesn't
no, I just
even.
had no energy. I was angry and I, just didn't feel good in my body whatsoever. And at that point, it wasn't like, oh, I want to be skinny and fit into this certain size. It was like, I don't like the way I feel. And, I had used my pregnancies and postpartum times to be like, oh, like I can do whatever I want because I'm pregnant and whatever. And now we can get into my pregnancy now and just what
Every
curveballs that.
pregnancy is different on so many levels, isn't it?
Right. But like,
Because
I
you're not
had
the same
never,
person you were that first or that second or whatever.
right. But I had never truly understood what it meant to actually take care of my body from a place of love. And so that was really my deciding factor in. Not only do I want to feel more comfortable in the physical body that I'm in, but I want to set myself up for being able to play with my kids and having the energy to live my life. And so I committed to starting a health journey, but knew that it just had to be different. It could not be from this place of shame. It could not be from this place of restriction. It could not be focused on vanity metrics. Like, it really had to be about the way I felt. And so that was kind of the gateway into this whole world of personal growth and personal development that I had never even known to exist outside of maybe some of the professional development books that I had read at work.
Sure.
And so it was around that time that I had started, you know, following other accounts that were talking about habits and how that could make such a big difference. And it was that, it was the first time I really started to let go of that perfectionism mindset too. I think New Year's resolutions is often such a good example of this. We like go into something with the best of intentions. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. And then we do it for like a week and then life happens. And then we're like, oh, well, throw that in the trash, like moving on back to my regular scheduled life. And, you know, it was at that time that I started to understand what it looked like to build habits through the lens of progress over perfection. Like, this is all about getting 1% better every day. This is all about recommitting to myself and understanding what it looks like to stand up and try again when I get sick or my kids get sick or a work meeting gets scheduled when I was supposed to be doing this workout. And so
I totally feel that. I got so burnt out on New Year's resolutions when I was working in the nutrition and fitness industry, because I feel like people look at New Year's Eve almost like they're like talking to a genie in a bottle or something. Mm-hmm. And they're like making like a wish, but it doesn't have anything like really backing it up. And there's definitely a good reason why most New Year's resolutions fail. What is it, like in the first 3 weeks? Is that the statistic or whatever?
Well, and now I understand so much more about goal setting and how like that New Year's resolution mentality like has a lot of attachment on the outcome, like losing the weight or doing this or doing that, and less about what does this process actually look like in my very real everyday life? And how do I stair step through habits to actually make a lifestyle change, which is different than being on a diet plan or being on someone's fancy workout regimen. Mm-hmm. And so anyway, throughout that time period, I went from being literally the opposite of a runner. When I say the opposite of a runner, like I grew up with asthma and like my parents told me that I couldn't run because I had asthma. Like, never in my life have I identified as anyone who runs on purpose. And I went from that to training for a half marathon, and then doing a St. Jude run that was 20 miles in like basically an evening. Wasn't necessarily
impressive.
Yeah. And so it was just like this whole revolutionary time in my life where I was physically starting to do things I had never done before, but it was from a place of love, not punishment or shame or anything like that. And so that's where I then started, you know, after kind of on the tail end of the biggest transformation there, that I'm like, this has been so profound in my life. Why is no one else talking about this? And so that's when I started sharing online and bringing women in rural communities into these conversations. So the habit challenge came about a year later. Basically, I had walked what I thought was going to be five or so friends through a habit challenge that I had done those first couple months of my health journey. It was like an end of year, last 90 days thing. And it was like these five specific habits. I had mastered it the year before. I'm like, well, this was really helpful. I'll help someone else who wants to do it. Five people turned into like 500 over the course of 3 months. And so we got to January and everyone's like, this has been so great. Let's keep going. And I'm like, I'm really sick of talking about drinking water. Like, I've got that one down. And so we started looking at other things. You know, having a habit challenge is not unique in itself. There's 75 hard. There's all sorts of different stuff. Sure. But nothing we were looking at made sense for everyone. And inclusivity is so important to me. And I wanted to create something that could bring the community together to do something as, you know, a unit. Accountability is so important when building new habits or working towards goals. But I wanted, you know, a stay-at-home mom in rural Ohio to be able to do her version of it while a CEO somewhere else is also going alongside of it. Like, and so that's where UDU 82 was created. At the time, I was teaching some group X classes because it was COVID and we all did weird stuff, right? Again, never
Oh,
thought
yes.
never thought I'd be a group X instructor, but here we go. What's a program director supposed to do when in a pandemic with no programs? Start teaching group X online. Okay. Anyway, so I would like demo a squat and be like, okay, here's the regular squat. Here's how you can modify it. Here's how you can make it harder, but you do you. Like, this is your class. Like, very much like whatever your body needs, like you figure out what you want to do and then do that. So you do you. 82. It rhymes. I'm a teacher by trade. Okay. And scientifically speaking, around the 3 month mark after being intentional with building a new habit, that's when it kind of just becomes part of who we are. So the premise behind you do you 82 is that anyone who participates, my community is primarily women, but my husband's doing it with me right now. So there's plenty of guys who do it too.
Oh, that's
and
awesome.
Kids, which is really cool. My son filled out, he saw me filling out my habit tracker and he's like, what is that? And I had an extra one and we figured out some stuff that he wants to do every day this summer. And he filled one out too. So,
that's awesome.
But anyway, anyone who does it can pick any six habits to intentionally build or break for 82 days through the lens of progress over perfection. And that is just something that I internalized in my journey of being so important in building new habits. But what I've seen is the byproduct of doing this over the past couple of years is women committing to this challenge and learning to undo that perfectionism in habits or changing their lifestyle has had a ripple effect in all these other parts of their life and letting go of, that perfection mentality at work or in parenting or in taking care of the house or whatnot. So many of us are, I say, like, have gold star syndrome. Like, we like,
yeah,
straight A students want the gold star. Like, if I'm not doing it perfectly, it's not worth my time at all. And the reality is, you know, anytime we're trying to make any kind of significant life change, it's not always going to go perfectly. And that's where a lot of us give up, because if we can't do it perfectly, why should I even spend my time? But
oh, so many reasons.
So many reasons. But
just fail. Just keep failing.
Right. But a lot of people need a reason to break out of that captive space that their mind is in of so unrealistic expectations of perfection, or else I can't do it at all. So yeah. So now it's been out in the world since January of 2021, totally free challenge. Anyone can start anytime. And it's very cool.
That's awesome. Very, very cool. I love that you created that. And I love how you created it. Really, it kind of came together in a very natural, intuitive, just kind of authentic way. That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. What are some other ways that you work with people?
So one thing that I had never been on my radar, like I said, when I left my job, I kind of had this vision for what this was going to look like. And I thought it was going to be very focused around habits, because that's what I had been sharing about. That's what had been really important to me. So I thought, oh, I'll be doing this habit coaching or maybe small group stuff with that. And still to this day, that is part of the work that I do. But as a new entrepreneur who was very used to working on collaborative teams, I mean, I had been a teacher and then I had worked in the nonprofit space, like being around people and bouncing ideas off people and working together to solve a problem was just part of my standard operating procedure. And here I am, an entrepreneur in my house in the middle of nowhere, going crazy in my own mind, trying to figure out what I was even doing in every aspect. And so in a voice memo of frustration to another friend I had gone to a retreat with, I'm like, gosh, I just wish we could like meet every week and, talk about this stuff. And I was just, it was really like a frustrated message of, God, this is so annoying. Like, I find so much value when we like sit down and have a conversation. Like, I get so much clarity on what I need and where I'm going when I don't have to just think about it in my own head. And she was like, then it sounds like you should create that. And it was this light bulb moment of course, I cannot be the only person that is dealing with this. And so right around that same time, as I call nothing short of divine intervention, I was invited to participate in a mastermind locally. And so that coach really helped me formulate the idea of what this could look like in a virtual capacity to serve my community. And so in, excuse me.
No worries.
I hope you have a good editor who can edit all my beautiful
Hey, you know
coughs
what? We all cough. I'm over here coughing too. I just, you know,
off.
it happens.
Or sometimes I like leave a note
real
on
life
my,
conversations.
yeah. Anyway, early last year, so early 2022, I brought this idea of masterminds for rural women to life. So they've kind of grown and transformed over the past almost year and a half. But basically, the through line between it is bringing together women in rural communities who are reaching for intentionality in different parts of their life. Oftentimes, that manifests as entrepreneurship, but not exclusively. I certainly have women who are in a variety of careers and life situations, but are ultimately really craving that space to celebrate their wins, talk through their challenges, bounce through those ideas, which is, you know, where my initial frustration was, and ultimately have that like personal board of directors and people that really truly are in your corner and are able to serve as a mirror to ask the hard questions and to hold you accountable to the things that you say you want to do while also holding space for what does it look like to actively pursue things through that lens of progress over perfection again and reiterate and change and be okay with evolving compared to maybe what you thought you wanted or what you thought you were creating, and then allowing that to grow and change over time to ultimately get to where you want to be,
Yeah.
which looks different for everyone, which is honestly my favorite part, because we hear so many different voices and ideas and reflections and representations, but there is this common denominator for, you know, most are connected to agriculture in some capacity, or are living in a small town, or are in a rural community. And all of those different things have different nuances, but it's like there's always this moment, like a session or two in, of like the sense of relief of like, oh, you get me. Like a lot of women feel like maybe their neighbors don't get what they're doing because maybe they're trying to build this business or start sharing online or parent differently or take care of their health differently. And like we referenced earlier in the conversation, that can feel so isolating when no one in your immediate circle has ever done anything like that before or stepped outside of the box. And to immerse yourself in a space where those goals and those dreams and that bigger vision for creating an intentional life for your family is celebrated and normalized is so empowering. And so those virtual masterminds then flowed into starting in-person retreats. I just opened registration for my third, which will be next year because this baby is coming this fall.
Priorities.
Yeah, it was interesting. Beginning of this year, I'm like, I don't know if I want to do a fall retreat or not. I need to sit with that for a second. And then I had finally been like, you know what? I think I just need to plan one for next year and focus on that. And like 2 days later, I found out I was pregnant. It was like our intuition knows before we even know, because it had
It
really
does,
been
literally. I think people sometimes say that and they're thinking, like, yeah, not really, but no, it really does. And when we listen to it,
really.
some pretty brilliant things happen.
Yeah, like there had been no logical reason for me to not do a retreat this fall. Like I had just had in my mind, I did a November one, I did a March one, I'll do another one this fall, and then another spring one. And yeah, it was after I was already pregnant, but didn't know I was pregnant, that I was like, you know what? Maybe this fall, maybe I need to focus on something else. Maybe I need to do something else. And sure enough, as soon as I felt pretty grounded in that decision, I found out. So it's kind of interesting. But we're going to Gulf Shores, Alabama. I'm very excited. A little beachfront property, because who doesn't need a beach vacation in March after a long, hard winter?
Absolutely.
And yeah, the time at our retreat is a really in-depth process of, you know, figuring out what you really want, asking those hard questions, and then laying out that action plan to move forward. So,
I love it.
that looks different for every woman who attends. And oftentimes people leave with different things than what they thought they were going to coming in. But the life change that I've seen in 3 short days is literally magical.
Yeah.
Literally magical. So it's
so fun to get to facilitate something like that. And I know if it's anything like the work that I do, you probably feel like you're learning and growing just as much as they all are, which always feels somewhat like, oh, this isn't quite fair, is it? I get to grow so much through this. But it's, I don't know, that's the beauty of choosing jobs like this and getting to enjoy the growth that you get through facilitating things like that. I love
Yeah. And
it.
it just feels like at the end of every retreat weekend, I'm just awestruck. Like, I get to do this. Like, it just feels like I said yes to something that is so much more than me. Like, whatever it is that's working through me, like, I am just the one that happened to agree to bring it to life and bring the people together. They're the ones doing the hard work. I'm asking questions and they're digging deep, but getting to see what they do, in the 1 month, 3 months, 6 months that follow is just like exponential, and growth that is on the outside and growth that's like really internal, important, like generational life-changing work. And so, yeah, it's very, very cool.
Absolutely. And it's just so validating when you've already like taken that like bold, messy action to follow your dreams, and then you start seeing the results of it and the way that you get to help other people do the same thing. And it's
Yeah.
just a gorgeous ripple effect. So
It's
I'm
so
so
cool.
excited that you decided to listen to what was on your heart and your mind all those years ago. And that's awesome. Where can people find out more about you, learn more about you? A place in this retreat, whatever they want to
Yes, I would love for you to come join me.
do.
So as you said, my podcast is called Gather in Growth, as in really just bringing people together with the intention of personal and professional growth. We talk about all the things. Teresa was on there. You'll have to listen to her episode. I think I walked away from that episode with more questions than answers, and it was phenomenal.
Thank you.
I'm most active on Instagram at Emily Reuschel, EmilyReuschel. I don't expect you to remember that or know how to say it. So
I'm
Teresa will
just
probably.
realizing I screwed up your name on your intro, so I'm apologizing right
No,
now because
I married into it. So I take no ownership. Like,
I get the
say
same thing. People always like Mrs. Levine. I'm like, no, it's Levine.
it's whatever. Like, I was Schmidt. People rarely mess that up in my maiden name. And I didn't know how to say my husband's name for probably weeks into us like talking. So it's fine, whatever. Also active on Facebook, and I have a Facebook group for UDU82 alongside my podcast insiders. So website's emilyreuschel.com. You can find out more about masterminds and retreats and the podcast and all that is to come.
Awesome.
So
Thank you so much for all of your insights and your stories and your fun conversation today. I really appreciate you being here,
thank
Emily.
you. I appreciate you. Thank you so much.
And thank you all for listening. Have a great day. Thanks for spending some of your precious time with me today. If you loved this episode, please leave a review or simply share it with someone else who would get great benefit from it too. If you share on social media, please tag me so I can personally connect and thank you. Until next time, keep taking bold and brave steps towards becoming more of who you want to be in this world. You are capable, you are worthy, and you are enough. And if your inner critic is still trying to argue with those facts, hit me up. We've got work to do.